about my learnings in tech to PhD years and so on. I'm sure many of you are curious to see isne kya kiya hai. Okay, with that, let me begin. So, what's my personal approach to sharing? So, I am comfortable with sharing a large amount of my experiences, failures, wisdom, whatever, okay, if it is likely to be of use to students. So, this is about my learnings, and the target audience are UG to PhD students, basically adults in the 18 to 30 age group is what I am looking at. So, if you are younger, then some parental guidance is required. And if you are older, then you can really relate with many of these things from your own journey. Okay. So, with some preamble, I'll begin. So, I'm 50 years old. Okay. This is approximately 26 million minutes of reel. And as a student, I spent 12 years, which is approximately 6 million minutes. And as a faculty, it's another 10 million minutes. Okay. So, that's your role, and now all of this has to be compressed into one film and so on. Thought might as well look at the lens of what might be useful to people in their 20s. Okay. So, how many people are there in their 20s? Okay, you are my target audience. Okay. Alright. Okay, so begin with, let me state the non-goals of this story. So, it's not to say that, okay, I have achieved all these things. Okay? That's not a goal. It's not to inspire people to mimic what I did, follow my path. Okay? So, both of these are non-goals. So, in other words, there is no feeling of trying to get you to do what I am doing and so on. Okay? That's the main thing. What's the goal then? So, the goal is to share my process, reflections, provide a case study for you, hope that it will be useful for you, for your process. That's the goal of this whole thing. And there's a bigger goal. Okay. That goal is to simply entertain you. Okay. Here's the broad approach that I'm going to take to talk about the story. It's a standard DBR cycles, okay, where the theory is our philosophy. Each stage I'll talk about, you know, what was the goal at that point in my life, you know, what was my approach to finding the answers, how did I decide to move on to the next stage and so on. So, instead of keeping it dry like a thesis, I thought, let me give some examples. Okay, so there will be some scenic detours which will happen, which are demarcated by this, you know, green background and whatever that symbol. Okay, one last slide before we get into the actual stuff. Okay, these are the caveats. So, the first thing is, you know, I don't really have much of a memory for past. Okay. So, I've tried my best, but I may still have got some timelines wrong, but all the events that I'm talking about actually happened. Okay. So, that's one. The second thing is a little more serious. So, this philosophy that I am going to talk about, it works for me. Okay? It's very personal. So, it may or may not work for you. You have to evolve your own philosophy. Okay? So, I am just sharing my philosophy as one more data point for you to evolve yours. Okay? And the last point is, it's a long story and it has a lot of points. Okay? It's like I said, it's 12 years worth of whatever learning. So, don't try to assimilate all of it right now. I mean, just enjoy the show for now. Maybe in the second pass, you can look at, you know, what to take for from it for your own learning and so on. Ready? That's the preamble. School year, so just one step back in the school. So, the had basically standard goals and a standard approach. Okay. And the key learning was value of effort, and what was missing was question posing, right? So, there was no question posing on why am I doing this, and all the questions were kind of, this is very common, it's, most of us have gone through this thing. We're just running because we've been told to run in some directions, you know, take JEE and all of that happens. And then come to the BTEC years, which is 17 to 21, and in first year is the basic taste of freedom, right? So the goal is to broaden learning, approach is to try everything. So I went crazy. So I did everything, everything as in literally everything, you know, doing some tinkering and swimming and running and tennis and this and that. And the outcome was there was lots of fun and learning. Can you guess the other outcome? Grades. Okay. So basically the grades went totally downhill. And the reflection was that, okay, we need balance and priority. So that was the first real learning that happened. Let's take a small digression into the scenic route here. So a whole bunch of certificate courses I did on ham radio and then rock climbing and mountaineering. That link is the institute from where I did the mountaineering course. And did like 7 days of trekking in the Sahyadris and 1 month of trekking in Kashmir at that time. And so there was an what is that called? Organization, not an organization. There was a an event that used to happen in those days called Himankan. Okay, so it was conducted by the mountaineering club, and we used to take large number of people to give them exposure to the Himalayas. Basically, like this YHA treks or the India hikes and all that that's there now. You know, they set up base camps and people come and people keep going and so on. So those things didn't exist in those days, but IIT had its own. So, and I was one of those guys who was involved in it right from my start. So, what are the skills that I learned? I learned tinkering, I learned how to handle logistics, I learned perseverance. These are like broadly some of the skills that I learned. If I try to transfer some of this learning, so one very interesting point I found that I have transferred right from my first year to here. Okay. So, then I was leading trek participants. When I myself did not know the destination. Often when you go on this Himankans, so you are also going to that next camp for the first time. And you are taking a whole bunch of people along with you saying, chalo chalo, idhar hi hai. Right? You haven't got a clue where it is. Alright. And that's exactly what we are doing now. Right? We don't know where the T-Lots project is going, and now we are kind of going along and trying to figure out where this destination is. Right? Okay.
So, was it all hunky-dory? No. There were several dark moments. Everyone would like to appear cool to their peers. But I was totally unsuccessful at this attempt to appear as a cool fresher. I also struggled to fit in with peers, the conversations and activities that were happening at that time. And finally, I had difficulty in figuring out who is my friend and who is not.
So the key point is, always have fun along the way. At least you have fun, right? Okay. So, second year I said, look, I'll show these fellows. What was there to show? Basically, a lot of my peers laughed at me because I was almost at the bottom of the class. Okay? A lot of guys, and these are all CS guys, right? I mean, top 100 JEE ranks. And what are you going to do and this and that, and I said, okay, I'll show these guys. What do these guys think? Only they can crack exams or what? So I said, okay, now this year I'm going to focus on cracking exams. Okay, guess what happened? I topped. Okay, there was no change in my grades. Okay, nothing happened. A huge depression happened actually. Okay, it was that bad. So, the interesting thing was, I still was doing a good job of learning. And those who studied from my notes got better grades than me. But I didn't get the grades. Okay, it was really bizarre. Okay, so that's when some switch came on and I started thinking like, look, this performance is not equal to learning, performance in exam. So, that's where ET began really for me. That performance is not equal to learning. And then started questioning the basis of academics that, look, there are so many other things which are not being tested. And that's when I developed an interest in psychology. So started looking at a lot of, pop psychology literature, right? So books like I'm Okay, You're Okay and so on. And it was basically to train myself in psychology. So I took all the HSS electives and institute electives that are compulsory for BTech students. All my electives were in psychology. Okay. Not that I learned too much, but I did learn how to observe people and how to not look at the gross actions and look at finer actions of people and so on. So the first thing that I learned here was that failure leads to learning. Okay. If I had not failed, I wouldn't have thought of looking at psychology at all. I would have said everything is fine and I would have gone ahead with, you know, becoming computer science kind of straight route. Okay, so let's look at some experiments that I did in the second year. So this is along the way. So one of the experiments I did was I was a used bicycle dealer. Okay. So this problem of bicycles lying around on campus has existed forever in IIT. So the fourth year batch would graduate and leave their bicycles and auction and so on would happen. And for whatever reason, I don't know why, I got the enthu to say that, okay, let me buy some of these, fix them and sell them. Okay, so I actually made decent money. A very interesting learning happened in this process of being a used bicycle dealer. Okay. I also learned to tinker, also learned to know that bicycle shop guy was my friend. All of those kind of things happened. The other job that I did was an electrician. Okay, fixing tube lights in people's rooms. So there was very interesting finding. Okay, people will pay good money to avoid simple household tasks, okay, like putting up a tube light. I mean, our rooms did not have tube lights. So all I had to do was buy a tube light, buy some rope, tie it up, put a switch, and people were willing to pay 50 rupees in those days. 50 rupees in those days. I was like, wow. So what did I learn? I learned some tinkering. I learned sales. Learned how to do some entrepreneurship, right? How to convince people that this is what you need, stuff like that. It was very interesting experiences. Okay, now here's one for you. Okay, suppose you sit in a tree outside H8, watching people pass by. How many people are likely to notice that you're sitting in the tree? Okay, how many people are likely to notice? None, some, few, okay, one or two people only look up. So you find that, you know, people are usually walking like this, right, or at most like this, nobody is looking up. I'm sitting right there, you know, on the road in the tree, okay, and nobody is looking up. So it was so hilarious. So I concluded that most people are preoccupied with themselves most of the time. Okay, I mean, you don't have to do the reflection spot. This is in movie mode. So when you are when you look at it in by yourself, maybe you should do the reflection spot and figure it out. A lot of learning happened for me when I did this experiment. Okay. Okay. So moving on. What did I transfer learning from my second year of BTech to today? So at that time it was gauging demand versus supply, trying to educate customers and relationships and so on. Today it's the same thing, right? We are trying to go and tell people that, look, ET is important, you have to start a department, why is the department required, all of that shows the customer is really perhaps not looking for the solution that you're offering. We're trying to figure that out. Okay. So anyway, the good learning that happened from this exercise was that, okay, you need to focus on end users. That's an important thing for us.
Although I did have a lot of fun, there were several dark moments. The unsuccessful attempt to get good grades really pulled down the confidence and started self-doubt. Then there was the struggle to figure out what is meaningful, what I should pursue. And this question keeps repeating periodically. And finally, there was the difficulty in balancing academics with extracurricular activities.
Coming to third year, so the goal was now to reflect on this learning. What am I doing with my life? Where is it going? Till then, it was all fun doing experiments just for the heck of it. So I said, okay, let's do some reading, doing, thinking and all of that. Okay, so how did I do this? Pretty much sitting at Vihar Lake. Okay, so in those days Vihar Lake was accessible, and pretty much sat there for hours and hours. I had a bunch of dogs which lived with me. Okay, and one of them was actually a mascot for one Mudai. All kinds of things have interesting things have happened. I had a squirrel. A squirrel used to live in my pocket. So baby squirrel till it grew up. So I know. See, none of these, huh? That's a good point, actually. So none of these I have actually sought for. Okay. Third year, I was doing okay academically, and there were some friends of mine who were not doing that well. And a lot of work that I had done was in tutoring them. So that's when in third year, I realized that I seem to have a flair for teaching. So whatever I can do, I can teach. So trekking, I was able to teach people. Playing volleyball, I was able to teach. And tutoring, just one-on-one tutoring, I was able to do. So that's when I thought, okay, look, perhaps I should become a teacher, right? So which means that now I need to focus on learning CS, not just on cracking the exams, right? So here's another amusing anecdote. Okay, I never got A square all through my BTEC days. There was one course in which I was the topper. Nobody in the class knew I was a topper, right? I mean, usually it happens, right? I mean, toppers talk to toppers. So Terku kitna marks mila? 37. Terku kitna marks mila? 36. But 38 is the topper. Who's 38? And you are sitting there quietly in the class, right? So it happened once, and that course the prof didn't give an A in the course. So I have never got an A in all my BTEC career. Okay, so what were experiments done in third year? So third year, one experiment was to walk barefoot. So I walked barefoot to class, everywhere on campus, said, TK, this month I'm going to walk barefoot. So just walk barefoot, just for the heck of it. Okay. Another experiment was not talking one day a week, you know, like they say in Hindi, Maun Vrat. Okay, Thursdays I'm not going to talk. I did that for a semester. So it was very interesting learning happened in this whole process. So people try to communicate with you when you're in that. They get frustrated and you are abused. It's not like a superiority thing, but it's like really amusing when that happens. Okay. So what was the finding? This was a very important finding for me. Okay. So once people say that, look, this guy is weird, they leave you alone. Okay. And then you can go about doing what you want, without worrying about what are these people going to say, what are they going to think about. So that was a big one. Yeah, so in third year of BTEC, I started, you know, collecting some quotes. I actually went and dug out this notebook of mine. And so, I mean, this was my way of learning. So I kind of, whatever I've read, I would find the quotes in that which appeal to me. And I'm sort of like a bullets guy, right? So, okay, this is the abstract point. And a bunch of these abstract points have been listed in this notebook. A lot of my learning happened by doing this exercise. Okay. And here I took a decision that I don't need to keep the names or the sources of where this learning is happening. And I'm more interested in what wise people have to say rather than who said what. Okay. So this decision actually has come back to bite me today, because I can't recall what research has come out of which research group. Okay. I always have difficulty on that because of this philosophy. Right, but what was the abstract idea that they came up with, you know, can we use that idea in another place? Those kind of things I can do. Okay, so what's the transfer of learning from BTEC third year? So I was running this Himankan, like I said, taking 200 people to trek in the Himalayas, organizing the thing and so on. And now we seem to be doing cute projects, struggling with sustainability at scale, right? How to do No Child Left Behind and so on. So there's a lot of, you know, organizational skill and, you know, some amount of leadership skill which is being transferred from there. Yeah, and one of the things that I learned was to focus on the immediate context. Okay.
Even though there were a lot of aha moments, there were also many dark moments. One of them was making peace with the fact that my grades do not reflect how much I have learnt in that course. Another one was the question, should I do what everyone else is doing? Should I give GRE, go abroad? And even if I decided to walk my own path, the question was, how do I do this while blending in?
Fourth year was saying, okay, I'm getting off the beaten track now. And the goal was to figure out what to do. And the finding was actually the opposite. I knew what I didn't want to do. I still don't know what I want to do. But I knew what I didn't want to do. So what didn't I want to do? Didn't want to be in the rat race. I, for some reason, said, look, I'm not going to exhibit this herd mentality or run after money or run after fame. Right? How did I arrive at this elimination? Okay, so here again, it was an interesting funda. So you look at somebody who has a lot of it, right? So if you take money, you look at these really rich guys, okay, businessmen like who have their own personal jets and this and that, and see, are they happy? And then you can come to a conclusion about, is that what you want, right? How many disadvantages they have to put up with? Or if you take fame, you know, you look at film stars or somebody who's at the peak of that, and then you say, look, these guys have no freedom, they can't walk around. So that was one way, that was my way by which I eliminated some of these. I still didn't know what to do. So the idea was that I still need more time to figure out what I want to do. Right? I don't know. And the solution was simple. I said, look, IITB is a nice place to hang around. I'm not done with Vihar Lake. I need to be around for some more time. Right? And then luckily there was also an official reason that I didn't know enough CS. If I had to become a CS teacher, I needed to know more CS. I said, okay, maybe I should do M.Tech. And that's when I joined for M.Tech. So here again there's a reflection spot which we need not do. But this technique, later on I came to know that this technique of eliminating is actually has a base in Indian philosophy. It's called the Neti Neti technique, okay, of reaching to the truth. Okay, let me see. B.Tech, one simple question. How many times did I meet my B.Tech guide? You meet me once a week. How many times did I meet my guide? B.Tech guide. Few times. Okay, you got that right. It was two times exactly. Okay. One time to start the BTP, one time to say I'm done. Okay, so this, it turned out to be that way. I mean, Professor Phatak was my guide, first of all. Okay, and then I knew that, look, going and sitting in his office and waiting to, you know, get time to discuss with him and all is, it's never possible. I don't know how many of you have actually seen him in action. Okay, he is this interrupt processor. Okay, so if you are talking to him, the moment the next person comes, he'll look there. He'll look there. So, and he'll go on processing interrupts and you'll get stacked, right? So, very early I realized in the first meeting itself, I think I was waiting for about 20 minutes to get one word in. So, then I said, look, this is not going to work out. And luckily for me, I was doing my internship at Godrej. I don't mean this to say that, look, there was no need to have a guide, okay? I did have a guide in the company. It's just that I didn't meet Professor Phatak too many times. Okay. So, what's the transfer of learning from fourth year? So, funny thing happened. So, I worked hard on a meaningful problem. That's what I thought, right? And then in those days, BTPs also had external examiners. So, but my external examiner was not impressed. He said, okay, look, you have logged it out. No, sitting right here, just below this room was where the lab used to be. This was the CS department in those days. So, you know, pulling night outs and running the program. Programs taking like 16 hours to run and stuff like that. And actually got it going, you know, calculated accuracy, calculated precision, and my examiner was not impressed. He was more impressed by hot areas. In those days, again, AI was hot. So, hey, this is the second round of AI. Okay, the first round was when I was doing B.Tech. Everybody was doing AI projects. So, that was the basic outcome, that you're not good enough. And today, it's kind of the same. So, that's again a transfer of learning that happened, that do what makes sense to you. This is what I took away from this whole process. In both cases, I knew that what I was doing was meaningful. Right? It was meaningful to me. And that feeling got strengthened. That look, if it's meaningful to you, you just keep doing it. Right? So here is another instance of where failure actually led to building strength. So because the recognition was missing, you got stronger to saying that, okay, I'm going to walk my own path. I'm going to do what I want, what makes sense to me. That was the idea.
Like most students at this stage, I was also plagued with many questions. What are my career goals? Where should I make my career? What do I want to do with my life? And if I do know that, how do I proceed to get there?
Okay, M.Tech years. This is a little more relaxed. M.Tech years actually are the best time of one's life, you know. Why? Because you already have a degree. So there's no pressure on you to get the degree. You agree? Right? It's the best time. Right? There's no pressure on you. And second thing is, you're not in a PhD that you are, you know, saying, are you 5 years, 4 years, I have to struggle. So M.Tech is a nice 2 year interlude between B.Tech and PhD. Okay. So what did I do in M.Tech? I did a lot of reading. You know all these books? This is the second one. Does everybody know the second one? Little Prince? Okay. So all of these books are, they've contributed to my learning. Okay, Steinbeck's Pearl, all of these are choto-choto books. You know, Three Questions is a short story by Tolstoy. Actually, it summarizes my, you know, the philosophy by which I live today. So you should look at it sometime. So did a lot of reading. Okay, a lot of Tolstoy's reading. Dostoevsky, have you even heard of him? You heard? Okay. Very, very tough to read. Right? It just depressed the life out of you. Okay. And Marcus Aurelius and Chinmayananda and, you know, Richard Bach and Hermann Hesse. Hermann Hesse, Siddhartha. Okay. Steinbeck, Faljam. How many people have read this? All I really need to know, I learned in kindergarten. A book like that. Yeah, okay. Yeah, and then there is a series of books. All of them are very nice. Very chota-chota stories. But there is some, and he's like a, you know, multifaceted guy. He just describes something and there's something to get in that. Huxley and then Russell and Thoreau. Thoreau, Walden, right. Walden again is a very good book to read. Improves your, you know, philosophy very strongly, you know. What is essential? What can be dropped? A lot of that comes from those books. Then, of course, there's a lot of time pass also. James Herriot is English vet, and Gerald Durrell is about wildlife, and Agatha Christie and Wodehouse, science fiction, many cartoon strip books, okay, biographies of scientists, sportspersons, Feynman, some Western philosophy, Eastern philosophy. Okay, how many of you have read Tao Te Ching? Okay, you should take a look. Basically, 81 couplets, which make a lot of sense. Zen, I'm sure you've read, right? You've heard of. Yeah. So, this is the stuff that I did in my M.Tech time. Then did more of doing and reflecting. So, this is when I started actually doing some workshops. Okay? Conducted workshops on CS topics. So, that time, a lot of us were, you know, into about teaching Linux skills and, you know, system administration skills and you know, programming skills to general people in IIT, and everybody wanted to learn that, so it was quite a high demand skill. Also started doing some part-time tutoring. Of course, those were mostly content-centric workshops. Today, when I think back, I don't know how much of learner-centricity was there in those workshops. Anyway, so did a whole bunch of campus activism on conservation with some learnings involved in that. Lot of treks, cycle treks, okay, going on bicycle treks. And then at some point, I said, okay, look, what I really want to do is something in rural education. I kind of zeroed in at this point. I want to get into rural education. But I didn't have the courage to jump into it right then. So, I took the easy way out. What is that? I went abroad. Okay. That was the easy route. I said, okay, look, I need more exposure. So, I went abroad. Everybody was going abroad. Right? It was the standard route. So, I said, okay, chalo, we'll also go and see. Okay. So here's the same question again. How many times did I meet my MTech guy? Two times? Once a month? Once a month? So actually twice a week. Okay. So this topic was on distributed systems theory, and Professor Damdari was my guide. It was not this twice a week was not any credit to me. It was entire credit was his. Okay. He had a daily 4:30 meeting slot. Okay. And I learned a lot of rigor and diligence. So the outcome was that my MTP got over in 6 months because I had to meet him. Every 2 days you have to meet the prof. So you have to make some progress, right? Okay. So here's a scenic route. So volleyball, I was like the captain as well as the coach of the hostel team. I was playing volleyball for IIT. I played bridge also for IIT. And what was the learning? So this was very interesting learning. You know, when you're both captain and coach, right? The coach is usually standing outside and seeing the team play. Okay. Captain is usually playing. The player has to focus only on his or her own play, right? So when you have to do both, it gave me this ability of being involved in it and being detached at the same time, because you have to wear the coach hat and you'll look at what's going on, you have to see what the other team is doing. Oh, yeah. So that kind of ability was very interesting. It developed some nice ability. And then of course being in the present moment, right? I mean, irrespective of what happens, you have to play for the next point. You know, if you let the score bother you, then you're done for. Right? So team management, these kind of things. So here's an interesting anecdote. Okay. So we were winning in one game. Okay, we were winning by a pretty good margin. And so our hostel fellows, they started cheering the opposing team. Arey, kuch to fight karo, no, give them some and finally we lost. So this was such a shock to all of us. So that time is again something I learned that look, if you fail to do something, and this happened not once. So once it happened two times in a row. So for three consecutive years, this business happened to us that we didn't go into the next round despite all the effort, right? I mean, practicing regularly, lot of work, everything. And then you finally find you still didn't make it. So here is again that the fact that didn't win, it led to a lot of growth, right? I mean, it led to learning things like, you know, being in the present moment, saying that, okay, what is really important? How do I still play despite how much does winning or losing matter in my life? So those kind of questions we were able to talk about. Then there was the trekking. So that time I went to Annapurna base camp, which was in Nepal. So again, here it's not a very easy one. So just keeping one foot in front of the other and so on. So the Sahyadri trek was actually a 4-day solo trek. So being alone is scary. So the Annapurna base camp, I had one more person going with me. So everyone, I had gone by myself. So if you enjoy solitude, you'll never be lonely, it's fine. But then this was really scary. So there was a time, this is Nanegat. Okay. So I said, okay, I'm going to do a solo night trek on Nanegat by myself. And brilliantly, I chose a new moon night. It turned out to be a new moon. Okay, I mean, the amount of fear that comes up, you know, it's amazing. So you say, okay, what's going on? So every sound sounds like something, you know, everything shaking, feel like are somebody is there, something is there, so on and so forth. But then just confronting that makes you strong. I survived. That's what I'll say. Survived, managed to go through the whole thing. So when I reach the top, there's a villager who comes up the next day morning. I was staying in the cave. Nobody's there in the cave also. So and one villager comes up. Then he's really surprised to see me there. So he says, oh, when did you come up? I went down in the evening, you were not there, and now you are there. So I said, yeah, mi ratri alo. So that guy says, ah, tasa kai nahi, fakta bhagachi biti hai. I said, what? So I mean, basically means that no big deal. It's just no, you have to be wary of leopards. So it was a good experience.
Even though I did a lot of reading and doing, there were still many depressing moments. I still hadn't figured out what exactly to do. I was wondering if I am making the right choices. And to top it all off was the question, why bother with all this?
Anyway, So it's again another reflection spot for you to look at later. I found that I was able to transfer learning from one domain to another, and you can think about whether you saw it happening in your life. Go to the PhD years. So far it's been mostly, you know, having a lot of fun. Here the serious business begins a little bit. Huh? So you think about what's going on and so on. So I went to Penn State, and in Penn State I did most of the applied courses. Unfortunately, it turned out that my advisor wanted me to work on something, and you know, I didn't want to work on that, and so it didn't gel too much with me. I also got disenchanted with the US lifestyle. You must remember that I was very young at that time. So I had some strong views. I don't have those views anymore here. So I said, okay, anyway, I've done all the applied courses. That was my interest. So databases and X-window programming, I don't know. Such courses don't exist anymore. So at that time, this whole thing about dragging from one window and dropping into another window, right? This was a course. Okay. So we did this entire back-end programming of, that's how CS develops, right? I mean, every generation takes the previous generation's work for granted. So when my teachers were standing here, they used to say, you know, writing assembly is really meaningful, right? And we were saying, we're going to write in assembly, right? And now I'm saying, look, we used to do that. And you're saying, yeah, these are drag and drop things. Who's going to worry about it? So it's like that. Okay. So I decided to return to India. And I had been still thinking about the fact that I hadn't picked up enough courage to do what I wanted. So I said, okay, I'll take the plunge now. So that was the intention of returning to India. So again, a lot of scenic route over there. I went to about nearly 15 national parks out of the 60 in the US, all along the East Coast and the West Coast. These are some of my favorites, Crater Lake and St. Helens and Rainier and so on. A lot of learning. Yeah, the interesting learning was that there are so many places to see, it's never ending. You can keep on seeing places, right? So at this point, because I did so much of it within 6 months, right? So that desire got satisfied, saying, okay, enough. So you can now find beauty and be peaceful wherever you are.
Even though I had a lot of fun and traveled a lot, it was a really tough time. There were questions about, am I taking the right decision? Should I quit or not to quit? I'm taking a non-standard decision. Have I done sufficient pros and cons analysis? And do I have the courage to actually take the plunge?
So I spent all my TA earnings in travel, right? Whatever money I earned in the US, I spent in the US. And I returned to India broke. Back in India. Now what happened? I said, okay, let me tour the country. So I spent like a few months doing that. Basic idea was to buy a ticket, get into a train, see where it goes. Or jump into a bus, see where it goes. So this was like a lot of learning happened in the process. It was mostly South India, right? I set off towards, Mysore, and I wanted to also meet some NGO people over there. So I set off in that direction, went to Kanyakumari, came back that way, and by the time I think it was done. Lot of close-up view of the vastness and diversity in India. Learn to keep pushing one's limit, how to function even though things are uncertain, right? I mean, it is going somewhere. So this is actually the tagline of our school I was part of growing up. So Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Vidya Mandir. So broaden the vision and deepen the roots. A lot of that actually happened. Some point found that parents are getting jittery. What's this kid doing? First he goes to the US, first he refuses to go to the US, then he goes, then he comes back, and nothing that this fellow is doing is standard, and now he is like loitering, going around the country doing some random stuff. So I said, okay, look, they are getting too jittery, I shouldn't give them so much angst. And I said, let me join for PhD. Okay, if anybody gave me this answer in an interview, just imagine. So just think of that. All right. The goal was to was to explore NGOs, go deeper. So this time, you know, there's a lot of serious reading. The Dialogues of Plato. How many of you have looked at it? Really good ones. Logic, if you want to learn logic, it's really there. Okay, reasoning ability, step by step. So the Dialogues of Plato are really something I recommend. Then works of Vivekananda. Did a whole bunch of doing, okay, working with many educational NGOs, right? I mean, these are some of them. Reflecting on what are they doing, how are they doing. Okay. So there was a lot of learning on how NGOs are run, because that was basically what I wanted to do. And then found that, no, there is this funding, reporting, numbers, all these are all issues with NGOs that you have to worry about. And yeah, so just thinking about that, also I found a huge diversity among the NGOs, right? I mean, there were people who were activists. Like, if you did not agree with that guy and if you did not, you know, commit to spending time on whatever issue that guy is working on, you're a bad guy. Okay, so there are people like that. At the same time, there are like very reflective thinkers. There are even people who game the system. Okay, so they have really no desire, true desire for bringing about change. But yeah, they get funding, they do this, they do that, and so on. And there are organizations which are very bureaucratic, even in NGOs. So that was one of my learnings. Okay, there's a whole bunch of anecdotes which I'm going to skip. But yeah, I mean, I actually worked in four of these NGOs. I worked fairly closely. Maybe one incident is worth mentioning, you know. So that is this voice, which was for educating children living on the railway platforms. So they had actually come up with a very nice curriculum. That was my first introduction to alternate curricula. So instead of starting with A for Apple, what they had done was they took objects in the railway platform and they were, and the pronunciation of that object, okay. So like ch for chai. So that's how the learning was going on. So those kids knew everything, but they didn't know it in the standard way. I thought like, wow. Later, much later, I discovered, okay, what it's called and so on. And the other thing that was true about the street children is that they're amazingly astute. So at that time, I worked with the NSS prof in charge and set up a visit for these kids to come visit IIT. I said, look, IIT is the best place, right? I mean, I've had a great time here and we'll get them here. So I booked some few rooms in the hostel and told these organization chaps that, okay, bring the whole lot. So some 20 odd kids, go leke aaye. And these are kids who are like, who typically live on the railway platform. And you find that these kids are so sharp, they can just look at people and say, is this a good guy? Is this guy going to, you know, take advantage of me? Is he going to harm me? Is he going to give money? And they were able to just keep saying that like that. I mean, at that time I was really amazed. Then I realized that it's a survival skill for them, right? Because they're on the street. So it's a very essential survival skill. And then I was wondering that, you know, who is teaching whom here? Right? I mean, there's so much learning for me that was happening in interacting with them. So it was really quite an amazing experience. Anyway, so there's a whole bunch of such varied experiences. But the key learning at the end of all this was that, you know, I may not want to join an existing NGO full time, you know, because there were everybody had some constraint or the other. So I said, look, I mean, that constraint doesn't work, this one doesn't work, so on and so forth. Okay. So one more thing. So people say, how's it going, PhD, right? Parents ask. I say, fine, it's going fine. Right? So, as far as the secret plan is concerned, it's going fine. Right? So, here's a very interesting anecdote. Okay, this was my first APS. So, my RPC paper says, hey, Sridhar, progress has to happen before the APS, not during the APS. So I was like, okay, at least sometime it's happening. All right. None of you have this. Okay, don't say that, sir. You did like that, so we are doing like this. It doesn't hold. Standards are different. Requirements are different.
Even though there was a lot of learning, there was also a lot of doubt. what to do had still not become clear. There was confusion about whether to jump into an NGO right away or whether to wait some more time. Many such questions persisted.
Okay. So second year, I said, look, you know, this NGO thing also kind of collapsed on me, right? I thought, okay, I'm going to jump into some NGO, and it was a very systematic way of approaching the problem. I said, okay, I'll come back, I'll first figure out, you know, I won't jump into something, I'll go explore, then I'll identify one which works for me, which is working in rural literacy, and then I'll go and join it. So that was the plan, and it kind of collapsed on me because I said, look, I don't think I can join any of these organizations. Now what? So I said, okay, let's seek some higher truths. So I said, okay, let's look at the one thing which I had not really looked at till then, okay, which was reading of teachings of various spiritual masters. Okay, so I read a lot of Osho's writings and, you know, Sri Sri's writings, Gita, Yoga Sutras, okay, read the teachings of Jesus, Buddha, and so on, right? Did the courses with Art of Living, also tried to do more work with these NGOs. So, and then a little bit of clarity started coming, okay, saying what, how should one lead one's life, okay, what are the values of, you know, respecting everybody, dispassion. Got kind of immersed in Jnana Yoga, Karma Yoga, and, you know, Bhakti Yoga. So this was again a very strange experience, because coming from a very strong scientific training and all that, you generally try to dismiss all of this as, oh, we are not part of this, right? And while Jnana Yoga was acceptable, Jnana Yoga is basically trying to find out the truth by inquiry means, right? It was still scientific. Karma Yoga was okay, which was saying that, okay, you are doing work and, you know, finding satisfaction in the work and so on. Bhakti Yoga used to kind of feel ki ye kya hai, you know, bhajan vajan gaake baithna hai, what is all this stuff? But then I found that there was a lot of pleasure in that. Not pleasure, there was a lot of devotion, right? I mean, the devotion is not towards a god or towards a guru. I mean, it's sort of, it's just there. Okay, so that was a very interesting experience which I had. That, okay, so then I used to kind of listen to it in the hostel wing and so on. And then when people would make fun, I'd say, okay, yeah, you listen to rock songs, I listen to this, right? So that's how it used to be. It worked fine. So what happened in the second year of PhD was that the approach that I had taken to find answers so far, which was to gather knowledge and, you know, try to determine what I should do, that approach collapsed on me, right? Just that, you know, going and, you know, trying to get more and more knowledge from the outside, that really didn't work. I said, look, this is not going to it's not going to work out. I mean, I'm running out of, not running out of time, but time is passing, I don't seem to be getting anywhere. So I said, okay, let's try going inwards. Now, that's what these guys are all saying, that the answers are there. So if you look at Patanjali Yoga Sutras especially, I mean, they say that, look, if you, in I think book 4, okay, if you want to know the answer to this, meditate on that, okay. So there are a whole set of this and that defined, okay. Only thing is that there is a precondition, okay. The precondition is that your mind has to be in a state of samadhi, okay. And in order to get to that state, there are, like, you know, hajar other preconditions and hajar other steps to be done and so on. But it's so beautiful that it says, look, if you want to know why this is there, or if you want to know about Ayurveda, get into that state, meditate on this. That's all. Right? It is so thrilling to know that, you know, there are such rishis who have discovered such knowledge and it is available. So I started doing all these things, right? Who am I? What's making me do things? What's the introspection, meditation, and so on. And again, here's another, this is a nice one. Okay, can you recall the tagline from my webpage? How many of you have seen it? Yeah, okay, two people. Okay, fine, anyway, I'll just, it's basically Anandamayi Chaitanyamayi Satyamayi Parame. So if you see my goal, first thing you will see is that. That kind of became my tagline after I started doing this. And this became my sort of motto to live by, right? To be, Chaitanya means always in consciousness, be aware. Okay, Satya means always being in truth. And the effect of or the consequence of being that is that you are joyful. Okay, so Anandamayi Chaitanyamayi Satyamayi Parame.
The spiritual exploration was a great deal of fun, but it came with the associated question of, does it make sense to leave everything and follow that path? If you choose to stay in the world, how do you balance between both aspects of your existence? Things were still not entirely clear and thinking was still going on.
So in third year, I said, okay, I am going to start my own NGO in education sector, and I called it the Good for Nothing Society. Okay. So I identified like-minded colleagues, wrote a manifesto, we opened a bank account, the works. Okay. The basic philosophy was only this much: do good for nothing in return, okay, expecting nothing in return. What was the outcome? Nothing happened. Okay, the NGO didn't take off. All right, it didn't take off. Why didn't it take off? It didn't take off because we couldn't agree on many things. The same things, problems that were happening in other NGOs that I had seen, however close knit a group, those problems started happening here. Okay, so it didn't take off, and then I realized, so this was kind of where my things started falling in place. Then I realized, look, service is not an action, it's an attitude. It's an attitude by which you live. It's not something you go out there and do. Okay. A very interesting digression. No? When I was making these slides, I actually found another organization called Good for Nothing. All right. It does similar work. It is so, I was thrilled to find out. Anyway, so here's the scenic route on the Good for Nothing. So this also, I took a lot of trouble to locate these things. Okay. I don't have the soft copies. These are all documents which I wrote when I was a PhD student. Luckily, I found one hard copy, really yellow old hard copy. So I took pictures of it and put it here for you. I'll give you a moment to read this one. So this was the idea, right? Saying that, look, let's just do something around ourselves. Okay? Just keep doing that. Forget about all these global things and so on. Let's just work local. Let's do that. And then there was a philosophy which came, which was do good and expect nothing in return. And this was all before Creative Commons and so on. But I said, okay, look, this belongs to all people. And so you must remember that I was 26 or so, and there's a lot of emotional stuff also in this. This was my real thesis, so to speak, right? It's about a 10-page document or so at that time, which I had written, and it kind of did it for me, doing this exercise. So we had an MOU between a group of people saying that, okay, we're going to open a bank account, we won't do this, we won't do that, so on, and we even had a newsletter. Okay, saying what are the activities that we have done, what are the upcoming activities, kya ho raha hai, those kind of stuff. So, I mean, we did it informally for almost a year, and then it didn't work out. Anyway, this is a good point for me to mention one of my friends. Okay, so his name is Subbaraju. Okay, so he passed away in 2017. He was an IITB M.Tech from M.Tech. Sitara was not there. He was an M.Tech in Energy Sciences. Did his PhD from here. He was actually responsible for introducing a lot of us to, you know, environmental conservation and so on. So what he used to do was, he used to stay in H1 and on the ground floor, and the entire space in front of his room was a nursery. Okay. And then a whole bunch of us used to be his army of people who take it and, you know, take it to the hill, plant it on the hill, water it every day and all of that. And the clarity saying that, look, let's just do what we can. A lot of credit I attribute to Subba for what I do. Okay. He also introduced a lot of good books. How many of you have read this book? How Children Fail. Very important book to read. I don't know if it's still in print. Subba used to make pirated copies of it on large scale and distribute them. Okay. So Anyway, so books like that, and today you can get them actually, PDF versions you can get. How many have heard of Arvind Gupta toys? Okay, a bunch of you. Okay, good. Yeah, so look at Arvind Gupta's website and you will find PDF versions of all these books, you know, really good books. Anyway, so what happened with GFN was that the founders could not converge and it became a personal philosophy for me. Okay, it became that's the way I now lead my life, saying that okay, service is not an action, it's an attitude. The way I talk to you is my attitude. Okay. So here again, the failure of the organization actually led to greater clarity, you know, what you want to do. And then I'm not going to talk about three questions. I've already mentioned that three questions earlier. It's a very cliched sort of story if you look at it that way, but it holds a lot of meaning also for me. Okay. So at this time, just after this experiment kind of failed, so I had this epiphany, saying that okay, what should I do with my life? I knew the answer. Okay. So the answer was, do service, work for the next generation of students. Okay, very broad, but at the same time, personally meaningful. So I said, okay, you don't have to go somewhere to do something meaningful. I've tried that. I've gone to a whole bunch of NGOs, etc., etc. I don't need to do that. I can be useful in CS itself. Now I've invested so many years in, you know, acquiring CS expertise. Why waste it? And so I said, okay, there's really no big difference between whether I go to a village and I'm teaching there or whether I'm doing it here with my own thing. Like I said, this is a very personal philosophy. It may not work for you.
Having decided to focus on completing the PhD, the standard question started bothering. Where is my thesis going? Is it good enough? And so on.
So I decided that let's do PhD. Okay. So the goal was to finish PhD, seek higher truths. So the approach was to work on PhD, and luckily for me, my guide was very understanding. Of course, I had told him, by the way, that I'm doing all this stuff. It wasn't like secret. So I told him, I made a deal with him actually when I started. So I said, look, this is what I need. I need time, and I don't need these weekly meetings. The other thing I did was, meditate regularly. The outcome was that PhD got done just in the 5 year, before the call ran out, and I got lucky. So IIT Guwahati was started around that time. I mean, this definitely, there's a big element of luck in what you become, where you go, right? Because when I joined for PhD, everybody told me, I mean, I was actually the last student in CS for a long time because nobody was joining PhD in CS. Okay, there was like a gap of maybe 3 or 4 years after me. No students had joined CS. And people had told me that, look, you won't get a faculty job, this, that, and all. I'd said, okay. But it turned out that, IIT Guwahati was started. I went there. And then in 99, CRISIT was started. And then, Professor Fatak said, look, I'm looking for people who will work on distance education, and that was my goal. So somehow IIT Bombay also hired me back, and that was the story.
There were a lot of dark moments even post-PhD. The biggest one being, am I good enough to be a faculty? But that's a story for another day.
Moving on. This sequel is yet to be produced. Okay. So I'll leave the sequel to the next movie. Let's just do a bit of quick reflections and then go into our discussion mode. Okay. So there's a lot of transfer of learning that happened from trekking. Okay. Trekking philosophy of reaching the top was not a goal. Okay. Having fun along the way. Okay. Going towards a goal is always more meaningful than reaching the goal. Okay, appreciate all that. All of that got transferred here. Basically, in our TLOTS language, don't fixate. Okay, so don't fixate on a predefined outcome. Keep going one step at a time. Always have fun along the way. So a whole bunch of learnings from different areas, which I am not going to talk about, because they are all pertinent only to me, and you can see it if you want later on. Okay. So how's my life today? Okay, I've done so much of this stuff that I'm satisfied. I really don't feel like, so many of you have asked me, right? I mean, many of you have wondered also, why is he so resistant to traveling? Itna fun hai travel mein. Many of you have felt that. No, why is he not doing this thing? This is the reason. I've done so much of it. I surely encourage all of you to do it. But I'm kind of comfortable where I am. It's like that. Okay. So now for me, work and fun are kind of interchangeable. Okay. So work is fun. Okay. But does that mean that everything is hunky-dory? No. Okay. There are still ups and downs. Okay. That's true for everybody at every stage. You know, every time one level, you go to the next level, there are ups and downs in those levels. You fix that, then you go to the next level, there are ups and downs in those levels. So that's always true. Okay. So getting overwhelmed with the number of things, right? This was actually the trigger for sending out the email itself, when I got the sense that, you know, people might be getting overwhelmed with the number of mails I was sending. Okay. So for me, getting overwhelmed, it happens to me also that, hey, I have to do this, I have to do that, I have to do that, you know, run to MHRD, run here, run there, and so on. So that's the trigger for solitude, which basically means that, okay, you need to do more reflection, you need to do more prioritization, and so on, and on to the next level. Okay. So how do I do this? How do I maintain this perspective? So when I begin to feel that I'm doing something important, I remember scale. Okay. So yeah, I mean, somewhere in the corner of the universe, somewhere in some planet, somewhere in some country, in some corner, you're doing something, right? So the moment you remember that scale, that feeling of, oh, I'm doing something great and, you know, mega, that goes away. On the other hand, you can get overwhelmed, right? You can say, oh, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, nothing is having an effect. So when you get overwhelmed, I basically do this. Okay. Just take time off. And lastly, you know, when I'm neither feeling overwhelmed nor, but I'm just feeling lethargic, right? I just don't feel like doing anything. What do I do? Fantastic. Cracked it. Yeah, it's actually talking to students. That's what energizes me. Okay, so because that's my whole reason for being is that. So, I mean, when two of you walk into my cabin and start saying something, you know, however lethargic I may be, I'm activated again, I'm energized again. So this was a big exercise for me, okay? I mean, now that it is all synthesized and all, it sounds okay. But like I said, I don't have much memory for past events. So, you know, actually sitting down and thinking what happened and, you know, to tell the story, how to tell the story and so on, took a lot of effort and time, okay? But this exercise has been useful, you know, to see how various events have contributed to me being the person I am today. So in a way, I am happy that I did this exercise. And, you know, as I thought about a phase in my life, I was able to recall the really important events, because all the details you forget. I mean, it's like 20 years ago, 30 years ago, you only recall the key thing that happened, and you are able to see it, you know, without getting emotionally affected, that was that really so and so on. Now coming to some reflection on making this story itself, it's been a great deal of fun. Okay, so a lot of fun exercising creativity, figuring out, finding these images and so on. Okay, what's the process that I followed? The standard ideate, create, refine process, which is there in Computer Masti book 6. Okay, so which basically says, okay, this is how you create a presentation, nothing more than that. And then, you know, this creative learning spiral. So this is nothing else but the creative learning spiral that I'm doing here, right? I ideated and then I created something, I played with it, I even tested it out and so on. Okay. So this is the last, I think, storyboarding. So just to give you some idea, it took me about 1500 minutes over 1 week. I did do one user testing, okay, 1000 minutes it took to produce the first product. And I did test with one user. So then I was really happy when he said, don't change anything, it's fine. I said, okay, fine. So this is likely to pass. And then I still spend more time to get some of these things into place. Okay. The point about technology, right? So here again, I initially thought we had been talking about powtoons and so on. So I thought, okay, let me try to use one of these tools and, you know, get some hands dirty with tools and make this and so on. So then I realized this is too complex a problem. I have to figure out the content, I have to figure out the pedagogy, and now if I have to figure out the technology also, I might just, you know, get sidetracked. So I used our standard rule saying that simple technology PowerPoint and hopefully it has worked. Okay, so here's some recommendation to the audience. Ready? Okay. So now that you've heard this, if any phase strikes a chord, you can discuss with your peers or with me and find your own magic potion. Okay. That's the point. And with that, there's no, nothing is ended without a learning by doing activity. So I'm going to skip this. You can do this later. Okay. Last, absolutely last slide. It's the overall reflection.